Hi everyone, let's talk about the cervical and brachial plexuses. In this video, we'll discuss the spinal nerves that participate in both the cervical and brachial plexuses. We'll also talk about how these plexuses are organized and what structures they serve. So spinal nerves originate from the spinal cord, and they're named for the various levels of which they exit the spinal cord in association with the vertebrae that they leave the cord adjacent to. There are 7 cervical vertebrae and there are 8 cervical spinal nerves. C1, or the first cervical nerve, exits above the first cervical vertebrae, C2 above the second, and so on and so forth. So C8 is exiting below the 7th cervical vertebra. Thereafter, each of the spinal nerves exits through the spinal foramen that's below the associatedly named vertebra. So for instance, T1 leaves below T1. The second thoracic nerve exits below T2, and so on and so forth. So the cervical spinal nerves are a little different than the thoracic, the lumbar, the sacral, and the coccygeal, as we'll see. So let's erase this and take a look at what we have here. So the first 4 spinal nerves of the cervical region, C1 through C4, will send their ventral primary rami out into the lateral neck to form the cervical plexus. The 5th through the 7th, I'm sorry, the 5th through the 8th cervical nerve, and then the 1st thoracic spinal nerve, so that's C5 through T1 ventral primary rami, will form the brachial plexus. The majority of the thorax lacks a plexus, so T2 all the way down through T12 is going to be plexus free, and then beginning below that we'll have the lumbar and the sacral and coccygeal plexuses. But considering this is a head and neck course, we only have to contend with the cervical and brachial plexuses. So let's start with the cervical plexus and we'll work our way on down the spinal cord. So the cervical plexus consists of contributions of ventral primary rami of C1 through C4. The cervical plexus has a couple of major structures which it serves, one of which you're familiar with already from our discussions of the anterior neck, and that happens to be the cutaneous nerves of the neck, which originate at the nerve point or herbs point of the neck that go out to serve the anterior and the lateral neck, as well as portions of the inferior posterior head, as well as up to the lower face as well, and down over the clavicle. So all of these green branches are cutaneous nerves. In terms of our efferents, there are a couple of structures served by the cervical plexus. Ansa cervicalis. Ansa means handle. Cervicalis of the neck consists of two limbs. So the superior limb comes down. That's from C1. And the inferior limb has contributions of C2 and C3. And these loop down over the carotid sheath. So these are serving the various infrahyoid muscles here. Also, contributions from C1 that are not of ansa cervicalis go out to serve the geniohyoid muscle and the thyrohyoid muscle. So the thyrohyoid is unique among the infrahyoids in that it's the only infrahyoid muscle not served by ansa, but rather served by independent fibers from C1. The diaphragm is another structure that is served from the cervical plexus, both efferently and afferently. So there are contributions of the ventral primary rami from C3, C4, and C5, which, if you're keeping track, C5 is not of the cervical plexus. C5 actually participates in the brachial plexus, which we'll discuss next. But so C3, C4, and C5 are going to come together to form the phrenic nerve. This phrenic nerve is going to be featured very prominently in the root of the neck. We'll see its association with the anterior scalene muscle, and it dives deep into the thorax, where it continues on. It sends some branches out to the pericardium, and then goes down to both efferently and afferently serve the diaphragm. So the mnemonic that we hear is C345 keeps the diaphragm alive. There are also some branches from the ventral primary rami of cervical nerves that are going to directly innervate some of the scalene muscles, the anterior and the middle in particular, but there's some variation here. There will also be branches of ventral primary rami of lower cervical nerves, such as 5 and 6 and beyond, which serve the scalene muscles. Sometimes we conceptualize this as being branches of the cervical plexus. Sometimes we say that these are just directly from the VPR of cervical nerves. You can conceptualize it however you like. I mean, these plexuses themselves are but concepts. They are intentionally defined by anatomists. So moving distally along the spinal cord, we have the ventral primary rami of cervical spinal nerves C5, 6, 7, 8, and then the first thoracic spinal nerve, T1. The way that I remember this is, you know, the old dance trope, C5, 6, 7, 8, T1. And so the brachial plexus is going to be the source of innervation for the upper limb, inclusive of the shoulder. The brachial plexus is organized hierarchically. So there are roots of the brachial plexus. These roots are the ventral primary rami, C5 through T1, not to be confused with the spinal roots. These come together variously. So C5 and 6 will be a superior trunk. C7 will be a middle trunk, and then C8 and T1 will be an inferior trunk. And then these trunks will form divisions. The divisions are either anterior or posterior. These divisions are named for their relationship to the axillary artery, which has been cut and removed here. And then there are cords that arise from various anterior and posterior divisions. So we can see there's a posterior cord from the posterior division. And then there is both a lateral cord and a medial cord from the anterior division. These cords are also named for their associations to the axillary artery. And then from, you know, both ventral primary rami and roots and trunks and divisions and cords come the branches. The branches are the named nerves that come from the plexus. And, you know, some of the big named nerves that you may have heard of in your previous studies of anatomy or just encountered in the world include things like the musculocutaneous nerve, the axillary nerve, the radial nerve, the median nerve, the ulnar nerve, and so on and so forth. These roots, so VPRs, are emerging posterior to the anterior scalene muscle. So they're actually sandwiched between the anterior scalene as well as the middle and posterior scalene muscles as they emerge laterally from the neck. So, big picture here, those roots of the brachial plexus, see 5, 6, 7, 8, T1, are not true spinal roots, but ventral primary rami of those spinal nerves. Those roots are going to coalesce into trunks. So there is our superior trunk from C5 and C6. Our middle trunk is just the continuation of C7. And our inferior trunk from C8 and T1 as they happen along. And that's the sum total of what you will be held responsible for in this course. The anterior scalene muscle here has been reflected away. We can see some of the middle and the posterior scalene muscles behind. Let's see, we have the left common carotid artery there. So there's the LCCA. There's the left vagus nerve, cranial nerve 10, right there. And coursing along the bottom here is the subclavian artery, which round about there turns into the axillary artery, which will be a very important artery for the brachial plexus in terms of its named terminology. If you recall, generally arising from the third part of the subclavian artery, but this may arise from the transverse scapular artery, or cervical artery, is the dorsal scapular artery. That dorsal scapular artery very frequently is going to travel between or insinuate itself between the superior and middle trunk of the plexus. So that's a really good classic anatomical relationship that you're going to want to hold on to in the memory bank. So as usual, I'll leave you with a question so that we can assess your understanding of the cervical and brachial plexuses. And that question is, which features of spinal nerves form the roots of the brachial plexus? So is it the dorsal primary rami of spinal nerves, C5 through T1, the trunks of the spinal nerves of C5 through T1, the ventral primary rami, the ventral rootlets, or the ventral roots of spinal nerves C5 through T1. So recall when we are talking about plexuses, cervical and brachial, we're talking about ventral primary rami of C5, 6, 7, 8, T1. So the correct answer is C. And just to review your nerve root anatomy here, so let's do a hemisected spinal cord. We'll do a little bit of gray matter within the cord there. So there is dorsal, there is ventral, so coming out of the dorsal horn, we have dorsal rootlets. These are going to coalesce into a dorsal root. Going in to the ventral are the ventral rootlets. These are going to coalesce from a ventral root. The dorsal root is ganglionated, so there is our dorsal root and ganglion, our DRG. So there is our dorsal root, and there is our ventral root. There's our trunk of the spinal cord, and then there is our dorsal primary ramus, and this is our ventral primary ramus. Dorsal root and rootlets are afferent. Ventral are efferent. Trunks are mixed. And rami are mixed. And so when we're talking about the portions of the cervical and brachial plexuses, we're talking about ventral primary rami. And cervical is C1 through C4, and brachial is C5 through T1. Thank you for your time.